All right, welcome back to the Copywriters Podcast with your host, the world's greatest copywriting coach, David Garfinkel. David, how are you doing today?
Nathan, I'm good. How are you?
I'm fantastic. And we record these episodes, about a month in advance. So it's July 4th as we're recording. And I'm just happy celebrating my independence and glad to be on the mic with you, man.
Yeah, me too. It's good to be here. Good to be with you.
All right, let's jump into it.
All right. Yeah, so listen, as a copywriter, sometimes your biggest problem is that your prospect doesn't have a problem. Well, that's not exactly it. Actually, sometimes your biggest problem is when you don't know what your prospect's problem is and you don't know how to communicate it to them in a way that your product can solve that problem. And if you can show convincingly that you can solve the problem better than anyone else, or you can solve the problem in a new and unique way that's, of course, different from how everyone else does it, even better. So that's what we're going to talk about today, how your customer's problem is actually your best friend. But before we do, here are some words that by now should have become your best friend. Copy is powerful. You're responsible for how you use what you hear on this podcast, and most of the time, common sense is all you need. But if you make extreme claims and or if you're writing copy for offers in highly regulated industries like health, finance, and business opportunity, you may want to get a legal review after you write and before you start using your copy. My larger clients do this all the time. So, to the topic of today's show, some people think that a life without problems is what you should strive for, but I disagree for two reasons. One, the only real life without problems is when you're a corpse. And let's face it, that's not really life. We always have problems. I think the life you should strive for, this is the second reason, is one where you can confidently and effectively deal with your problems, because sooner or later, one will be there. It's just the nature of life. Now, as a copywriter, how does this help us? And that's what today's show is about. Here's the thing. Your prospects are walking around with problems they desperately want solved. All of them, all the time. And if you can articulate those problems better than they can themselves, then you've got their attention. And when you can present your product or service as the hero that saves the day, well, that's when the magic happens. So we're going to do two things today. First, we'll talk about how to uncover your prospect's core problems. Second, we will drill down on one of the most valuable things you can do once you know the core issue for your prospects, and that's write a problem solution story. Mm-hmm. But wait, there's more. There really is. We'll look at some other persuasion story types you can use to piggyback on what you learned in your research about prospect problems. Any thoughts before we jump into this?
Immediately, what's coming to mind, I think Eugene Schwartz did the problem awareness diagram, and that's kind of the thing that's coming to my mind. And when you started off the show, some people have a problem and they're not even aware of the problem. And I found that those people are always the hardest to sell to. So I wonder how that plays into today's episode, but I'll just leave it at that.
We'll see if that comes up. How's that?
All right.
All right. So let's get into our first step, our first section, and that's finding out what the problems your prospect has that your product can solve. Finding out about all of them, and then zeroing in on the one that you can solve best and uniquely. So if you're going to use a problem solution story, understand that the picking the problem part of the story is not like throwing darts at a pub after you've had a few beers. It's more like a trained marksman with a high-powered weapon and a precision scope. Now, I don't mean you need to shoot anyone. You definitely don't and shouldn't. I'm using this startling metaphor to get your attention to this point. To make a problem solution story really work, you need to pinpoint the biggest problem that your prospect is already aware of, problem aware, or can easily be made aware of. So maybe the answer to your question, Nathan, about those who aren't aware of the problem is, if it's going to be hard to get them to become aware of the problem, that's really dicey. If it can, you can do it easily, then that's good. Mm-hmm. And this problem also needs to be the one you can solve well and in the best of all situations in a uniquely valuable way, if at all possible. At least, well, definitely in a valuable way, and uniquely if you can find a way to do it uniquely and show that. So, all right, that's the whole schmagegi, but how do you go about finding these problems? Well, we've gone over this before, but since I found most people still aren't doing it, why not review it one more time? Real quick, here's how. First, talk to customers. You know, talk to customers, ask questions, shut up and listen to the answers, really listen. You'll find out about pain that you never thought of. And when you do this, you want to ask open-ended questions. Those are the ones that begin with how, when, and what, and maybe why and where, mostly how, when, and what. And these will be answered in a conversation instead of giving them questions that you can only answer yes or no. Okay, after you've talked to some people, spend some time doom scrolling. Yeah, you heard me right. People love to complain on Twitter and Facebook and to a lesser degree on LinkedIn. Now, I know you swore off negativity, but guess what? The thing people complain about, those are problems. And if the same problems keep coming up over and over, you know it's a common problem that maybe they haven't found a solution to yet. Mm. Also, check competitor reviews. Check Amazon, check Yelp, check Google reviews. What are people complaining about there? What issues keep coming up? Same idea. The more common the problem, the more likely it might be the one that you want to use in your problem solution story.
Just a side tangent. I just moved into a new house and I'm putting up curtains, and I noticed the windowsill is different than the wood and frame around it. The windowsill has like a slick marble finish to it. And I was like, wonder why the windowsill is different. And then I thought, oh, probably somebody built a windowsill the same as the rest of the surrounding area and it rained. And it probably rotted, and somebody complained about it, and it was a problem. And then somebody said, well, let's make a new window seal that has some sort of waterproofing to it. And a lot of times, products and services kind of evolve that way. We put something out, we listen, or somebody else puts something out, we listen to the problems that people are having with it, and then we make a slight improvement on it. So whether this is research on competitors' products or just improving your own stuff, I know we don't like to hear the negative feedback about things, but hearing the negative feedback is what makes you rich if you listen to it.
Yeah, really good points. Yeah, I mean, a lot of inventions and innovations happen exactly that way, I suspect. So, yeah, that's great. All right, so let's get back to finding the problem as a general rule. As a general rule, the more immediate and quickly you can solve the problem, the better it will work on the solution side. So there's problem and there's solution. The faster you can solve the problem, the faster the solution, the better, at least in your story. To say, I had trouble reading the fine print, so I started doing these eye exercises, and a year later I can read it. That's not going to work quite as well as, a week ago I was having trouble reading the fine print, so I got a new prescription for my glasses, and today I can read everything. Mm-hmm. That's just an example to show the different between immediate solutions and long-term ones for the sake of the story. Okay, so let's say you've identified the problem. How are you going to describe it? Don't use technical cursive knowledge description. Don't say something like, delays in response time are diminishing the impressions of our interface with the public is rendering. What does that mean anyway? Use the same language your customers use. If your customers say, "I hate how long it takes to get customer support," then you can say, "Katrina never wanted to call because she hated how long it takes to get customer support." Mm-hmm. See? Easy. Or you could create a vivid description that throws the prospect right back into the experience of the problem. For example, "It's no fun when you're constantly distracted and missing deadlines. Do you feel overwhelmed by your never-ending to-do list? You've probably said to yourself, there must be a better way." That's a pretty good problem description. Look for emotional triggers related to the problem. What emotions are tied to these issues? Frustration, anxiety, anger? Highlight these emotions in the problem part of your story to make the problem feel real and pressing. Like this. "You know the anxiety about unfinished tasks, that knot in the pit of your stomach? It's true. Missed deadlines cause a lot of frustration for everyone." Anxiety, stomach knot, frustration. Those are the emotions people really feel. Finally, and you're still in the research and brainstorming phase, don't be afraid to look beyond the initial problem. Go one step further. See if there are any ripple effects of the problem in your prospect's life. While the solution you're going after is short term, sometimes you can amp up the intensity of the problem by describing the long-term effects. Mm. Like this. "Remember, when you miss a deadline, you risk losing a client. And getting distracted all the time doesn't help either, because it can reduce your productivity and impact your job performance. Over time, this can cause stress and burnout." Now, you don't necessarily need or want to use all of this in a simple problem solution story, but it's good to have more than you need so that you have some choices when you're putting it together. And if you don't use it in this particular story, it may come in very handy in some other parts of your copy.
What I really like about this is it feels like rubbing salt in the wound. If I've just got a cut, I might not want to solve the problem. I might just be like, it's just a small cut, I can deal with it. But when you rub that emotional salt in the wound, and you gave the example of using all of the technical words, that doesn't really do it. But when you get to those emotional, evoking type of words, it feels like rubbing salt. And then I'm like, oh my gosh, this hurts. I need a solution. Please help me.
Yeah, exactly. And those are the words, and that's the thought stream that we live in our real lives, outside of the persona we put on to look professional and intelligent and sophisticated. And that's where sales happen too. All right, let's move on to our next step. So we've talked about how to find the problem. Now let's talk about how to show your product provides the best solution. That should be your goal. Now, if you can't provide absolutely the best solution, all is not lost. At least try and make it different from other solutions out there, and interesting enough so someone's willing to give you a try. Okay, this is important. Listen closely. The reason products get scoffed at as commodities and people are only willing to pay rock bottom prices for them is because there's nothing noticeably better or different about what they offer. So when you find and describe your solution in your story, this is your chance to make sure people are willing to pay for the value you're offering. Okay, so let's talk about putting this problem solution story together. Start with a problem you've already identified. Put that inside a personal story. Simple example, weight loss. The problem is you weigh too much and you haven't found something you can do to lose the weight. For example, let's say you're selling a weight loss supplement. Begin with a scenario that many people can relate to. Imagine stepping on the scale and seeing a number that makes your heart sink. And what is worse, you know everything you've tried in the past haven't worked. Now, you can take this one step further by adding some physical and visual descriptions like this. Your clothes are tighter. Your energy is low. and you avoid mirrors because you don't want to look at the overweight person you'll see there. And you can push it to near the breaking point by spelling out what would happen if the person in the story doesn't solve the problem. So here's an example of taking the problem to the breaking point. You know that if you don't take care of this problem, you're putting yourself at risk for things like diabetes or heart disease. Plus, your confidence will be on the line, and this could have a bad impact on your relationships and your life at work. Finally, introduce your solution. But what if I told you there's a simple, effective way to turn this around? A lot of people who have had no lasting success with anything before are getting great results with our supplement that helps you shed those extra pounds and regain your vitality. Now, this is just for illustration. Weight loss is an easy example to use here, but you need to really know what you're doing to stay in compliance. So keep that in mind too. It's just a teaching example. Okay, so you got your story done, or at least the first draft. Now what? Well, read it out loud to see if it flows conversationally. If it sounds clunky, smooth it out. Make sure it sounds like you're talking to a friend. Get rid of adverbs and most adjectives. Instead of saying, "You'll feel incredibly energized," leave out the "incredibly" and just say, "You'll feel energized." Mm-hmm. Use colorful, evocative verbs. Instead of saying, "You'll lose weight," say, "The pounds will start to melt off you." Can you hear the difference between "you'll lose weight" and "melt away"? If you can use a metaphor, a simile, or an analogy, do that. Think of our supplement as your personal trainer in a bottle, keeping you on track toward your fitness goals. I just saw you highlighted something in the script. What are you thinking?
I just love the fact that some behind the scenes stuff, we've been playing around with teaching AI to write like us and treating it like a copy cub. And those two examples that you just gave about get rid of the adverbs and most adjectives and use evocative verbs. I'm like, oh, David's taking what we're doing outside of the show and bringing it into the show. So just a little behind the scenes inside baseball right there.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. And busted. That's exactly where I got that from. Okay. So now, here's another thing when you're putting this story together. Remember, the story is something you assemble into a larger piece of the copy. I think the biggest mistake is to write a micro story, a 5-paragraph story, and expect it to do all the heavy lifting to get the prospect interested, to bust all their objections, and to close the sale. That's ridiculous. What it's trying to do is create some emotional belief and conviction and openness to what you're going to say. It doesn't have to do all the work. So the way you assemble it, the way to look at it is you have some other copy and you lead into the problem, then you tell the story, and after you finish the story, you segue smoothly to the next part of your copy. Make sure that your voice in the story matches your voice in the rest of the copy, unless it's somebody else telling the story and you say so, right? If you're quoting someone else, you could have a different voice, but otherwise keep it the same. Consistency is key. Make it sound like the same person all the way through. Mm-hmm. Now, in the next part of the show, we're going to talk about using the problem solution pieces you've developed in other kinds of persuasion stories. And this can lead to even greater emotional impact and motivation to buy your offer. But as we wrap up this part with problem solution stories, let me suggest that once you've got all these basic components of this one piece you're going to assemble into a larger piece, once you have all your components, you try out different problem solution story structures. See which one works best. Maybe it's a past future structure. Like 6 months ago, Jane was in the same position as you, struggling with weight and low energy. Today, thanks to our supplement, she's 30 pounds lighter and has boundless energy. Or you could leave out measurable details, which is always a good idea if you can when you're dealing with weight loss. A personal story like this. I used to dread stepping on the scale. Now I look forward to it, thanks to our supplement. And you can get rid of those feelings of dread yourself. Here's another example, step by step for a productivity app. Start with a relatable scenario. Picture this, it's Monday morning and your to-do list is already a mile long. Use vivid imagery. Emails are piling up, meetings are back to back, and you're juggling multiple projects with looming deadlines. Build tension. Without a system in place, you'll feel overwhelmed and stressed, impacting your productivity and job satisfaction. Introduce your solution. But imagine if you had a tool that could streamline all your tasks, prioritize your workload, and keep you on track. Meet our app, the ultimate productivity partner. Refine the story. Think of our app as your personal assistant, always ready to organize and optimize your day. And finish strong. With our app, you're not just managing tasks, you're mastering them. It's designed to turn chaos into clarity. Nice. Okay, that's what I got. What do you got?
I'm just going to add in one thing. You talked at the beginning of this segment about separating your offer from all the other offers, making it to where it's not just a commodity. And what immediately came to my mind, I think it was John Carlton. Was he the one that wrote the Blue Blockers promotion?
No, that was Joe Sugarman.
Joe Sugarman. Okay. The Blue Blockers, I remember these. This is what got me into copywriting as a kid or into marketing as a kid, because I immediately realized, oh, everybody, there's sunglasses everywhere. It's such a commodity. And he said, hey, check out this problem that most people have with sunglasses and check out this solution. This is why ours are different. And this problem can lead to this other problem and can affect you in this way. And we figured out a way to solve that problem. So it's just like sunglasses that you're familiar with that are a huge commodity on the marketplace, but ours has a slight twist that makes it better because it solves this one problem. Having that slight twist that solves a problem commonly known, whether it's the weight loss industry, whether it's my pans are sticky and I need something that doesn't stick, whatever it is, having that slight twist that makes yours solve a problem that the marketplace is familiar with can make your product stand out and be the go-to. Everybody has to get this one rather than all of the other versions of it out there.
Yeah, that's really good. And you bring up another point. You don't want something that's so unique that it comes across as weird or alien or unfamiliar. You want something that's familiar, but with that unique quality, just like demonstrated. Really great point. Okay, so let's talk about other types of persuasion stories you can use once you know the problem. We're going to take some famous ads from history to show how this works. But of course, you can do this today in 2024. So different kinds of persuasion stories work across different situations. But if you can take the problem you spent so much time identifying, you can try plugging it in to a different kind of story. For example, did you realize the famous Claude Hopkins ad for Schlitz beer was really a problem solution story masquerading as a qualifications track record story? You didn't? Don't worry, he probably didn't either. But the ad worked, didn't it? It took Schlitz to number one on the beer charts. So what old Claude found out was that consumers don't trust claims about beer purity. Now that was a problem, you know, back in the day. Of course, you don't hear guys at bars arguing about beer purity these days, do you? No, because Claude Hopkins settled that question years ago. Here's how he did that. At the time, in the early 1900s, customers were skeptical about beer purity claims. So he told a qualifications track record story for Schlitz. In one ad, he got really granular, describing the steps Schlitz took to purify their beer. He wrote, "We sterilize every bottle, not once, but four times. We use filtered air to prevent contamination." Now, who does that? Only the most successful copywriters in the world. They get very granular. So let's break it down. remember, we're talking about a problem solution framework and weaving it into a qualifications track record persuasion story. So here are the steps he used that you can use yourself. Just substitute the problem you're dealing with for beer purity. Here we go. One, identify the problem. Consumers don't trust claims about beer purity. Two, showcase your track record. Highlight the steps you take to ensure quality. Three, use specific, vivid details. Make the process come alive in the reader's mind.
I want to add real quick. I read an interview one time, and they were saying that when he first approached them with this promo, Schlitz said, "But everybody does that." And Claude said, "Yeah, but the customer doesn't know that everybody does that. And if you're the first one to inform them, that sets you apart from everybody else." And it worked.
Yeah, I mean, that's true. Everybody knows that. Everybody does it. Everybody knows that with the curse of knowledge and in the beer industry at the technical and executive levels, but nobody else does. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, really good point. Okay, now let's take a fresh look at something we've talked about before, Apple's famous 1984 commercial. And in case you don't remember, at the time in 1984, a lot of people were freaked out by the growing incursion of technology controlling our lives. Different from what people are worried about today with AI and cell phones for kids, but basically the same kind of fear. Mm-hmm. Apple addressed this fear, which was the problem. The fear was the problem, not with a problem solution story, but with a predicted transformation story that started with the problem. That is the fear people were feeling. The commercial started with the threat of this horrible future where technology enslaves people. And then enter the Apple Macintosh computer, the liberator. The predicted transformation was a future where people were liberated from their fears of technology. Okay, the ad was a success, but did Apple keep us from getting enslaved by technology? I'm going to have to ask the ChatGPT app on my iPhone to get the answer to that one. So I'll get back to you on that. But for now, let's break this down step by step. Number one, identify the problem. Problem here, fear of technology controlling our lives. Two, predict a negative future. Describe what could happen if the problem isn't solved. Three, introduce your product. Present your product as the solution that changes the predicted future. In other words, creates the transformation. And let's do one more. Probably not an issue for you and me, not having heads full of hair no more, but how about Head & Shoulders Shampoos, The Science of Beautiful Hair? This was a persuasion story that describes a product's mechanism, but it uses the problem solution. So in its campaign, Head & Shoulders addressed consumer skepticism about whether a shampoo could really help people with dandruff. And the way they did this was to explain how Head & Shoulders active ingredients eliminated dandruff at the root. Step by step, one, identify the problem, skepticism about the product's efficiency. Two, explain the mechanism, describe how the product works. Three, use clear, simple language, make the explanation easy to understand. So you can see, you can take the groundwork we've done for a simple problem solution story and work it into any number of different kinds of persuasion stories, as these advertisers have already done.
I love all of these examples today, and I think it's time to do a quick recap.
I agree. All right, so let's recap with what we've covered on the podcast. We started with identifying customer problems. Next, we moved to showing how your product provides the best solution. We talked about putting together a compelling problem solution story. And three, we explored how to use the problem and solution you developed in other kinds of persuasion stories besides problem solution stories. Now you have a chance to try these things out yourself. I would urge you to start trying out more of these storytelling techniques in your own copy. And for a comprehensive guide with templates and examples for 25 kinds of stories to help you sell, I'd like to remind you about my new book, The Persuasion Story Code. It's available on Amazon, and it's a really good resource for putting all kinds of stories into every kind of copy. And we'll put a link for that in the show notes.
And if you want to get the show notes, you can head on over to copywriterspodcast.com. We've got almost 380 episodes up over there so far. So if you want to do a deep dive and turn yourself into a master copywriter, check it out, copywriterspodcast.com. Link for David's book in the show notes. And David, I just want to say thank you for taking the time today. It's the 4th of July. You showed up to help record this episode. And the irony of doing a story about 1984 on the 4th of July is not lost on me. But man, thanks again for coming through and just constantly delivering high value.
Oh, you're welcome. Thanks for being here with me.
All right, man. And until next time, we will catch you later.
Catch you later.